Hello students, I'm Dr. Parminder Kaur, Assistant Professor, Department of Economics. In the series of lectures that I'm delivering on growth and economics of growth and development, I'll be today discussing Rosentin Rodin's Big Push Theory. Rosentin Rodin was a developmental economist who worked in London School of Economics, taught in various prestigious institutes of the world, and was a firm believer in the balanced growth strategy. He presented his theory, his ideas, in a 1943 paper which was titled Problems of Industrialization of Eastern and Southeastern Europe in an Economic Journal. According to Rosentin Rodin, the most important reason responsible for low level of development is the small size of markets in developing countries. Now, small size of market means the demand in those economies is very less, as a result of which individual investments that are made by the investors are not profitable. We must keep in mind that private investment happens or takes place with profit in mind. And because of lack of, demand in the market, these individual investments are not able to make profit. So he talks about complementarity of industries. Complementarity of industries means that industries need to be, dependent on each other, mutually benefiting each other. And he has explained this theory very interestingly with an example of a shoe factory. So he says that, let us say that there is a shoemaking factory which employs, let's say this is a shoemaking factory A which employs 20,000 laborers. Now, these individuals who received employment, so employment will lead to increase in incomes. Increase in income will lead to increase in demand. But will these 2,000 laborers demand the shoes that are being produced by this firm or industry? No. The demand that will exist in this industry will be a mixed demand. That means they will demand not only shoes, but maybe foodstuff, clothing, education. So a mixed bag of goods and services are demanded by individuals. So for lack of demand, if there's just one industry, it will not be able to survive. So if we imagine a situation, rather than one industry, simultaneous investment is made in a number of industries A, B, C, D. So because of interdependence of these industries on each other and because of complementarity of these industries, A will demand products of B, C, D. Similarly, B will demand products of A, D, and so on. So this will lead to interdependence, widening of the size of the market. So Rosentin Rodin's theory is basically known as theory of big push or big investment. Imagine a developing country, small investments, or he also refers to this as bit by bit allocations. That means meager investments will not lead to development. If you want the economy to develop, huge amount of investments at the same time in various industries, in various sectors need to be made if we want to break this vicious cycle of poverty. For instance, let's take a country that is developing. The level of productivity, this low level of productivity leads to low level of incomes are low, as a result of which demand will be less. Demand is less as a result of which investments will be less, and investments are less, so the capital formation will be less, and because of low level of capital formation, the productivity of that economy will be low. So if the economy has to break this vicious circle of poverty and emerge and get into a virtuous circle of prosperity, a huge investment simultaneously in a number of sectors must be made for it to progress on the path of development. Rosentin Rodin has explained his theory of Big Push with the help of three kind of indivisibilities that he talks about. The first indivisibility that he talks about is of production function. The second is indivisibility in demand. And third is the indivisibility in savings. Now, one by one, I'll try to explain what these indivisibilities actually mean. The indivisibility of production function. Production function essentially is a technological relationship between inputs and outputs. Now, for any kind of investment to be profitable, it is very important that the economies of scale that have been explained by Alfred Marshall are realized by the firm. The economies of scale can be of two types: internal economies and external economies. Now, when the size of the industry increases, as a result of which all the firms which are a part of that industry also tend to benefit. These are known as external economies. This can be in the form of research and development, marketing economies, development of infrastructure. So they benefit if the scale of operations increase. As a result of increase in production, the cost of output per unit should decrease, leading to increase in the profitability of the firm. So the most important indivisibility that Rosentin Rodin talks about is that of SOC. Now, I'll explain to you what is the meaning of SOC and DPA. We need to understand here what is the meaning of the term SOC. SOC means social overhead capital. So before any area, let's take any example of a country or a region that wishes to develop. What is the prerequisite? A conducive environment has to be generated that can be fruitful or can be useful for investments. So if a region has to be developed, the basic infrastructure in the form of power, in the form of transport, communication, various utility services need to be provided to the investors before they can actually invest. So SOC is investment on the infrastructure that is a prerequisite for DPA. DPA is the directly productive activities. So when government provides us roads, railways, airways, energy, power, cement, steel, these are all basic heavy industries with a lot of forward and backward linkages, and they create a positive environment for the investment from the private sector. We should keep in mind that private sector is a profit-driven sector, and the government has to invest, and there is indivisibility of SOC. That means there is a certain sizable initial lump of investment that needs to be made. The investment that is required to be made in infrastructure is huge, and at times the developing countries do not have a private sector that has this such kinds of funds, or there's lack of institutional support who can actually help in financing such huge projects. So it is the government that must initiate this process of development of infrastructure. So this is known as indivisibility of SOC. That means if government makes huge investments, the output or the ROI of this investment can be realized only if there's a simultaneous development of a number of industries. There's a private sector that comes forward and produces a number of consumer durables, non-durables and services, and makes optimum utilization of these social overhead capital investments that the government has made. I'll discuss the various kinds of indivisibilities of SOC. The first is the timing. It is very important that the investment in social overhead capital needs to be made by the government before the quick yielding DPA is made by the private sector. It is irreversible in time. That means this has to precede the investment that can be later on taken forward by the private sector. it has minimum durability. So let's take an example. When a highway is constructed or a hydropower project is taken up, or if a huge investment is made in heavy and basic industries, they have certain amount of durability. Okay, so there is this durability makes the investment very lumpy, and the gestation period is very long. We need to understand here what is the meaning of the term gestation period. Gestation period essentially means from the time of investment. Let's say in a hydropower project, government invests 100 crores in the year 1990, and this project becomes operational only in the year 1996. It takes 6 years for the project to for completion and start generating electricity. So the time between 1990 to 96, that is the time between the initial investment that is made and production of output and profit generation, is known as gestation period. The private sector does not have the patience, nor the funds, nor the desirability to make such kind of huge investments and wait for longed for profits to come in. So it is the government sector or the government who takes these initiatives, and this is known as indivisibility of long gestation period. Now there is a minimum industry mix of different kinds of public utilities. For any kind of conducive investment environment, a multitude of services are required, and simultaneous investment needs to be made in a number of public utilities so that a private investment can come up, and DPA is accompanied by SOC. As stated in the beginning, the most important drawback of a developing economy is the small size of market. Now, this small size of market is there because of the low per capita income. I had drawn a vicious cycle of poverty that these developing countries are caught up in. And because of low level of development, the incomes are low, demand is less, and as a result of which, the size of the market is also very small. So it is very important that the size of the market be expanded. So this is known as indivisibility of demand. As discussed earlier with the example of a shoemaking factory, a number of factories, industries need to be set up simultaneously so that they can complement each other, can be a source of demand for each other, as a result of which the size of the market can be widened. Now this can be explained very clearly with the help of a diagram, which I'll be doing. This is the diagram that shows us various levels of demand. D1, let's say, is a demand curve showing a low level of demand. That is also, as you all must be knowing, it's the average revenue curve. And then we have the MR1, that is the marginal revenue curve. Let's for now just focus on four curves. That is the average revenue, this is the demand curve, D1. MR1, this is MC, is the marginal cost curve, and AC is the average cost curve. Now we all know that the point of producer's equilibrium is where MR is equals to MC. And the MC curve needs to cut the MR curve from below. So this is the point E1, is the point where MR curve is cutting the MC curve from below. And if we extend this point, we'll be able to get an idea of what is the average revenue and average cost at this point. Average revenue, if you look at the average revenue curve, it is the average revenue is BQ1. It is BQ1. Average cost, if you look at this point, AQ1, average cost is AQ1. Average cost is greater than average revenue. This means the firm is incurring losses. When the cost is greater than revenue, the firm incurs losses, and the loss per unit is equals to AB. This is the loss per unit, and if you want to find out the total loss, the total loss will be loss per unit into the total output that is produced. So this shaded region, P1CAB, is the loss that the firm is incurring for lack of demand. Now when the demand increases and we have a different demand curve, D4, showing us a high level of demand, and we have another corresponding marginal revenue curve, MR4. Now you look at this situation, the second situation. The point of equilibrium is E here. If you see, the average revenue curve is higher than the average cost curve. So the average in the second situation, the point of equilibrium is E. Average revenue is equals to RQ4. Average revenue is equals to RQ4. Average cost is equals to SQ4. So average revenue is greater than average cost. That means the firm is incurring profit. So the profit per unit is RS. This is the profit per unit. What will be the total profit? Profit per unit multiplied by the total output that is being produced. So this bigger rectangle, that is P4 RS P1. This is the profit that is being earned by the firm. So this diagram very clearly explains that at times when the demand is less than the required demand, the firm is not able to make profits. So there's a certain amount of demand, critical demand, that must be there in the market. So the size of the market should be sufficient so as to generate profit for the firm. The third kind of indivisibility that we, Rosenthin Rawdon, talks about is indivisibility of savings. Now we know income is equals to consumption plus saving. Now the levels of income in a developing economy are very low, but the consumptions have to be met from this very minimum disposable income, as a result of which savings are low. So the marginal propensity to consume is high, marginal propensity to save is low. But for the development of the economy, it is very important that capital formation takes place. And how does capital formation take place? It takes place when these savings, when the savings are invested, this investment leads to capital formation. So there is a certain, because we want simultaneous investment in a number of sectors, in a number of industries, we need to have that kind of capital. And that kind of capital, we need to have that level of savings. So this indivisibility also Rosenthin Rawdon talks about. And the solution for this, according to him, is that incomes should increase so that the MRS, that is a marginal rate of saving, should be higher than the average rate of savings. In other words, the income of the general population should increase so that they should be able to save more. And if they're not able to save more voluntarily, they can be taxed, and compulsory savings can also be made by the government. So we have to keep in mind that it's capital formation that is very critical and crucial. And when you're talking about simultaneous development and simultaneous investment in a number of sectors, it is important that capital formation takes place. So in total, we've talked about three kinds of indivisibilities: indivisibility of production function, indivisibility of savings, and indivisibility of demand. And Rosenthin Rawdon says that because of these indivisibilities, it is very important that investment takes place in a balanced manner and the economy grows in a balanced manner. But there are a number of criticisms that have been leveled against this theory that has been proposed by Rosenthin Rawdon. The criticisms that have been leveled against this big push theory are essentially that this theory focuses a lot on infrastructure development, SOC, and completely neglects the agriculture sector. And if we analyze, most of the developing countries are a huge percentage of population in these countries is dependent upon agriculture. So for instance, if we take the growth experience of our own country, India, too much of investment in infrastructure in the 70s and 80s, not accompanied by simultaneous investment in the consumer and durable goods, led to inflationary pressures in the economy. Because when income increases, people demand a mix of goods. And these mix supply of these goods must be available in the market if we have to control these inflationary pressures. And nowadays, the focus, is on self-reliance. Government spends a lot of money for import substitution, export promotion, and generally the external economies that Rosentin Rodden talks about are not realized in case of these activities. And most importantly, in developing nations, the administrative and the institutional setup is not very efficient. It is not able to deliver. There is corruption, red tapeism, nepotism, lack of technical expertise. So the implementation of programs is not done effectively, and it is not prepared to take such kind of huge investments together. And if we look at this theory historically, we've seen that we have examples of a number of Asian countries, India also, where it was not huge investment made at the same time. But so this theory is not historically proven, and it is not like a solution for any country desiring to break its vicious circle of poverty. But nonetheless, it is important when we study developmental economics and the various prerequisites that Rosentin Rodden talks about are very much relevant even today. Thank you.